Welcome to the New Glarus Bible Church website. We're thankful that you're visiting with us today. My hope is that you will be strengthened and encouraged in your faith as you listen to the message and perhaps as you even sing along with the songs before and after the message. Let me just tell you a little bit about our church. We are a Bible church, and that means that everything that we do is centered around the Bible. Every Sunday morning, I have the privilege of asking the congregation to open their Bibles to, and I give them a specific passage. What I do is I explain it, and then I give some application on how we might apply it to our lives in the coming week. We're a family-oriented church. We have families in our church from all different ages and stages of life. We have a men's ministry, which includes a Bible study, oftentimes a breakfast and men's events. We have two women's Bible studies going on currently. We have a wonderful Awana program that is growing and reaching out to the local surrounding communities. And we have a youth group, which is led by a great young couple from within our church. And at the center of all these things, New Glarus Bible Church exists to glorify God by bringing people into a life-changing and growing relationship with Jesus. We know that lives are transformed as people dedicate themselves to become lifelong and fully devoted followers of Jesus. We invite you not only to visit our website, but also join us some Sunday morning. And our worship services begin at 10:30 a.m. each and every Sunday, and we are located at 207 6th Street in beautiful New Glarus. We'd love to see you sometime soon. Thanks.
I will remember the deeds of the Lord. Yes, I will remember your wonders of old. I will ponder all your work and meditate on your mighty deeds. Your way, O God, is holy. What God is great like our God? You are the God who works wonders. You have made known your might among the peoples.
Father God, we come before you today, and we are especially thankful for our mothers. And today we want to celebrate them. Today we want to encourage them. Lord, I pray that you'd use this service today to do just that. Father, I pray that you'd use the music. I pray that you'd use the message. I pray that you'd use the encouragement or the fellowship amongst us to encourage each other. Lord, use today for your glory. And I pray this in Christ's name. Amen.
Praise the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in his mighty heavens. Praise him for his mighty deeds. Praise him according to his excellent greatness. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they will never perish, and no one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of the Father's hand.
Thank you.
Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all the day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us.
Turning your Bibles to Genesis chapter 16. That's where we'll be today. And it's Mother's Day, and so we're especially delighted to hopefully encourage them. Today I want to talk about finding hope in the middle of our grief. And can everybody hear me well? I'm competing with the rain today, so want to know if you can hear me. Did you know that there are 8,032,688,887 people in the world? Did you know that? And all of them were born of a mother, every single one of them. Without mothers, none of us would be here today. And I think that you all are familiar with the fact that mothers are different than dads. Both are needed. Both of them play different roles in the lives of their children. Moms are nurturing. They're consistently loving and caring. And when a child skins their knee, who do they run to? They run to mom, right? That's right where they go. Dads are known for adventure. You know, we like, when we go to a playground, we play tag with our children. Mothers like to sit on a bench and kind of watch. When moms swing their children, they swing them gently. When fathers swing their children, they like to do the undertow, you know. And we're just different. Moms are known for safety. There's not a mother in here who hasn't said, be careful, 1 million times, right? Dads are known for just being fun. And so anyway, we're different. Moms are known as the schedule masters. Everyone knows. She knows everyone's doctor appointments, all the dentist appointments. Moms are the ones the children go to. They ask moms questions like, I'm lost here. But anyway, they go to their moms and they ask, you know, what are we going to do today? What are we going to eat today? Mom, can you read for me today? And the question I would hear at home when the children would come to ask me a question would be, Dad, where's Mom? And that's about the only question that I would get. So mothers really do deserve a Mother's Day for all that they are and for all that they do. Mother's Day for many moms will be a joyous occasion. And I am hoping that each and every mother here today will, you know, receive cards and flowers and be taken out to eat. But for other mothers, Mother's Day can be very, very challenging. Can be very, very challenging because mother wasn't there for you when you were young. Perhaps because mother was dealing with her own issues, maybe drugs or alcohol. Or perhaps Mother's Day is not a day of celebration because your beloved mother died and she's no longer here for you to celebrate with. Perhaps your children have moved away, either emotionally or physically. And for some mothers, you know, their children are in the midst of making bad choices. Some of them are choosing sinful lifestyles. And so Mother's Day is a day of loss rather than a day of celebration. I went to a pastor's conference this week, an event that was held at Memorial Baptist Church in Verona. The event I went to is called the Pastor Theologian Collective, and a man was there who had written a commentary on the book of Job, or how to preach the book of Job, and he said something very, very interesting. I wrote it down. He says, everyone you preach to is grieving. Everyone that you preach to is grieving, because every person that you preach to has lost something. You know, perhaps they've lost some possessions, perhaps they've lost a relationship due to death, or maybe conflicts that led to the death of a relationship. Some have are grieving because they've lost their health. Some people are grieving because they've lost their career or their job. Everyone has lost something, and everyone is grieving. Our speaker told us that he has asked this question when speaking on this topic. He has asked the question, what are you grieving? And he has said, and merely asking the question causes some people to tear up and causes other people to cry. Another man said this. This is Joseph Parker. He lived about 100 years ago. He said, speak to the suffering and you'll never be lacking a congregation. There's a broken heart in every pew. And today what we're going to be doing, we're going to be looking at a story in the Old Testament. It's found in Genesis chapter 16. It's the story about Hagar. And Hagar was a very good mother. And Hagar was put in the midst of a mess. We're going to see that. We're going to walk through her story today and then make some observations on what we can learn from Hagar.
Hagar was a really good mom, and she was dealing with the messiness of life. And in the midst of this story, what we're going to see is the faithfulness of God. We're going to see the faithfulness of God. Hagar had to deal with a lot of grieving because she lost a lot. We'll be seeing that today. Hagar had to deal with a lot of injustice. There were a lot of things that were stolen from her. And what I'm hoping that we can take away from today's message is that what gave her hope and what enabled her to carry on when other people might have just given up. That's what I'm hoping to do today. And so the story begins in Genesis chapter 16. I want to walk us through it. The main characters in the story are somebody that we call Father Abraham, the father of the Jewish nation. His wife, Sarah, or Sarai. We're going to see Hagar, and we're going to see her son, Ishmael. And then a little bit later in the story, we're going to be introduced to Isaac. But Abraham is the patriarch of the Jewish nation. He and Sarah are listed as heroes of the faith in Hebrews chapter 11. What we're going to see in this story is they're very human. They're very self-centered. They're very sinful at times. We're going to see that in this story, even though they're listed in the Hall of Faith in Hebrews 11, during this passage, we're going to see that they exemplify a lack of faith. So in Genesis chapter 12, you don't need to turn there. We're going to start in Genesis 16. But in Genesis chapter 12 is what we call the Abrahamic covenant. And God said to Abraham, I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you, and I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. God said to Abraham in Genesis chapter 12, I'm going to make you into a great nation. But in Genesis chapter 16, Abraham and Sarah are childless. Verse 1. Now Sarai, Abram's wife, had borne him no children, but she had an Egyptian maidservant named Hagar. So she said to Abraham, the Lord has kept me from having children. Go sleep with my maidservant. Perhaps I can build a family through her. In these few verses, what we see is that Hagar's innocence is stolen. What we see in these few verses is that Hagar's future is stolen. She is a young Egyptian maidservant. She is being told by her boss, Sarah, I want you to sleep with my husband who's 85 years old, and I want you to bear us a child. She, in essence, is losing her innocence. She's also losing a future that she might imagine one day marrying a man because she loves him and one day establishing a family. She's not envisioning her future with an 85-year-old man. And Sarah is, in essence, looking at her in the same way you would look at cattle. I need more cattle, therefore I'm going to put these two cattle together so they could give me a calf. She's looking at her maidservant as a thing, not as a person. Let's go down to verses 3 and 4. A little bit later in verse 2, still, Abraham agreed to what Sarai said. So after Abram had been living in Canaan for 10 years, Sarai, his wife, took her Egyptian maidservant, Hagar, and gave her to her husband to be his wife. He slept with Hagar, and she conceived. When she knew she was pregnant, she began to despise her mistress. This is just really a sad, true story. And so now Hagar is despising her boss, her Sarah, and who wouldn't? I mean, when she was in this family earlier, she was a maidservant. Now all of a sudden, she's sleeping with her boss's husband and producing a child. And so what happens in this relationship, Hagar despises Sarah. Obviously so. And then what happens is that a rift grows between them, a rift grows in the family. When Sarai said to Abraham, "You are responsible for the wrong I am suffering. I put my servant in your arms, and now that she knows that she is pregnant, she despises me. May the Lord judge between you and me." So all of a sudden, her maidservant Hagar is, when she turns sideways, you can see that little baby bump, and Hagar is glowing. She's with child. Sarah has been barren her whole life. Sarah is jealous of Hagar. Hagar all of a sudden kind of like holds the cards. Things have shifted in their family relationship. And all of a sudden, where there had once been peace, there is now conflict. Verse 6. It's interesting that Sarah blames Abraham. She's the one who asked for this situation. Sometimes we ask or we demand things, and then we get what we want, and after we get what we want, we don't want what we got. Have you ever done that? That's what's going on with Sarah. But it goes on to say, Abraham says, "Your servant is in your hands. Do with her whatever you think is best." Then Sarah began to mistreat Hagar, so Hagar fled from her. She ran away. She did the only thing that she could do. She could stay in the home and continue to be abused, or she could run away. And this is a picture that represents her going out into the desert. She's all alone. She doesn't know where to go or what to do. And so she is praying to God. In verse 7, it says, "An angel of the Lord found Hagar near a spring in the desert. It was the spring that is beside the road to Shur. And he said, 'Hagar, servant of Sarai, where have you come from and where are you going?'" For Hagar to run away, she's actually breaking a law because she is a possession. She is not a person. She is technically property, and she's running away. She's not supposed to do that. But she ends out in the desert. She's been abused. She's been mistreated so severely that she runs into the wilderness. Her life has been irreversibly altered, and her future looks bleak. It says here that an angel of the Lord appeared to her. What we call this is a Christophany. This is the Lord Jesus Christ. The pre-incarnate Lord Jesus Christ is appearing to her. And I want you to see how he deals with her. He calls her by her name. He doesn't treat her like a thing. He treats her like a person. And he asks her this very personal question. You know, where have you come from and where are you going? She jumps right into the situation. She says, "I am running away from my mistress, Sarai." She has nowhere to go. She has no money in her pocket. She's in the middle of the desert. She has two undesirable options. Either she can go back to her home and continue to be misused and abused, or she looks out over the desert. She's trying to figure out where to go. She can die in the wilderness. These are her two options. Let me ask you a question. What would you do? Where would you go? This is the plight of an abused woman. She can go home and be abused, or she can run away to Norway, to nowhere, and perhaps die. This is the plight of a man. I don't want this sermon to just be about women. I want us to understand that this is for all of us. This is the plight of a man who's locked into a job that's going nowhere. He's being abused on the job site. So look at what the angel of the Lord says. Verse 9. Then the angel of the Lord told her, go back to your mistress and submit to her. That's not exactly what we would expect to hear from the angel of the Lord. Where's the comfort in that? But this is the Lord Jesus Christ, the angel of the Lord, speaking specifically to Hagar. This is what I want you to do. I want you to go back to your situation, and I want you to submit to your mistress, Sarah. The angel added, I will so increase your descendants that they will be too numerous to count. In other words, what the angel is telling her is this: I want you to go back to Sarah. You're pregnant, and one day you're going to give a child. You're going to have a child. You're going to have a child, and then what's going to happen from that one child? There's going to be so many descendants. They're going to be so numerous that you can't even count them. In other words, what the angel of the Lord is saying is, you know what? It's not over here. I've got a plan for you. I've got a future for you. Trust me. Go back home. He says here, you are now with child, and you will have a son, and you shall name him Ishmael, for the Lord has heard your misery. What does the word, or what does the name Ishmael mean? It means the Lord hears. God hears. For the Lord has heard your cries. The Lord has seen your misery. And the message throughout Hagar's story is this: God hears, God sees, and God cares. That's the message through this whole story. And this is the message for us when we're in the midst of a mess. God hears your cries. God sees your misery, and God cares. That's the message that we want to hear or see in this message. He goes on to say, he will be a wild donkey of a man. His hand will be against everyone, and everyone's hand against him. And he will live in hostility towards all of his brothers. Soon we will understand why. Why that is so. She gave this name to the Lord who spoke to her. You are the God who sees me. For she said, I have now seen the one who sees me. That is why the well was called Beer Laher Roy is still there between Kadesh and Bera. In other words, the name of the well or the name of the spring means the Lord who sees me. So Hagar bore Abram a son, and Abram gave him the name Ishmael, God hears, to the son she had bore. Abram was 86 years old when Hagar bore him Ishmael. When Hagar met the angel of the Lord, this is what happened. She became a believer in God. One of the things that happened to her there is she had a new perspective of her problem. She had a new identity, and because of that perspective and because of that identity, she was able to go back and live peacefully in that home where she had been abused. Let's look at Genesis chapter 17, verses 15 through 18. This is later. At this point, Ishmael is about 13 years old. God also said to Abram, as for Sarai, your wife, you are no longer to call her Sarai. Her name is to be Sarah. I will bless her and will surely give you a son by her, and I will bless her so that she will be the mother of nations. Kings of peoples will come from her. Abram fell face down. He laughed and he said to himself, will a son be born to a man 100 years old? Will Sarah bear a child at the age of 90? And Abram said to God, if only Ishmael might live under your blessing. In other words, what had happened is this. Abram son, Ishmael, born from his loins, they had 13 years together. And during those 13 years together, they had a father-son relationship. As a matter of fact, Ishmael was the only son. And so they spent a lot of time together. When God looked at Ishmael, he's thinking, you know, this is where the blessing's going to come from. This is where the nations are going to come from. But then God says to Abraham, no, you're going to have a son from your wife, Sarah. And so he's saying, well, why can't we just do this through Ishmael? And God says, no, I have a different plan. Let's go to Genesis chapter 21. We're going to read the rest of the story. I'm going to start in verse 1. Now the Lord was gracious to Sarah, as he had said, and the Lord did for Sarah what he had promised. Sarah became pregnant and bore a son to Abraham in his old age, at the very time God had promised him. Abraham gave the name Isaac to his son. Sarah bore him. When his son Isaac was 8 days old, Abraham circumcised him as God had commanded him. Abraham was 100 years old when his son Isaac was born to him. Sarah said, God has brought me laughter, and everyone who hears about this will laugh with me. And she added, who would have said that Abraham, that Sarah would nurse children, yet I have borne him a son in my old age. She goes, this is amazing. This is amazing. This is just as God had said. The child grew, and he was weaned, so it's about a year later. And on that day Isaac was weaned, Abraham held a great feast. But Sarah saw that the son whom Hagar the Egyptian had borne to Abraham was mocking. So here's Ishmael. He's about 14 years old. And he's watching Isaac, who's about a year old. They're having a great feast, a great celebration. And this is what Ishmael's thinking. Oh, great. They're having a big party. Because Isaac's 1 year old, and now he's no longer going to go to mom for meals. And so what he does is he rolls his eyes. And Sarah sees this. And what is her response? We go and we look. This is what Sarah said. Verse 9. But Sarah saw that the son whom Hagar the Egyptian had borne to Abraham was mocking. And she said to Abraham, get rid of that slave woman and her son, for that slave woman's son will never share in the inheritance with my son Isaac. She doesn't even call Hagar by her name. She calls her that slave woman. Get rid of her. Get her out of here. Get rid of that Ishmael. Just get him out of here. And then what we see, what did Abraham do? The matter distressed Abraham greatly because it concerned his son. He looks at Ishmael and says, he's my son. But God said to him, do not be so distressed about the boy and your maidservant. Listen to whatever Sarah tells you, because it is through Isaac that your offspring will be reckoned. I will make the son of the maidservant into a nation also, because he is your offspring. Early the next morning, Abraham took some food and a skin of water and gave them to Hagar. He set them on her shoulders and then sent her off with the boy. And she went on her way, and she wandered in the desert of Beersheba. When I was in Israel, one of the things I observed is there's a lot of barren land in Israel. There's a lot of acreage there where you just can't produce anything. And so this mother, who's probably like 35 years old, is being sent into the desert with her 14-year-old son. I imagine that it looks a little bit like this. She's out there going, Lord, what am I going to do? You know, she feels abandoned by God. she has lost. She's living with Abraham, and they're living in a prosperous home because Abraham was rich. She's being sent out into the desert. She's lost. She's bewildered. She's shell-shocked. She's without a plan. She doesn't know what to do. She is suddenly homeless. She is cast out to the wilderness once again, and she feels abandoned by God. And their water runs out. And Ishmael is thirsty. So Ishmael, she puts him underneath a bush for some shade. And then it goes on to say, when the water and the skin was gone, she put the boy under one of the bushes, and then she went off and she sat down nearby, about a bow shot away, and for she thought, I cannot watch the boy die. And as she sat there nearby, she began to sob. She is convulsing with tears. She has lost everything. And I want you to think about Ishmael for a moment. He too has lost everything. He has lost his father. He has lost his home. He has lost his safety. He has lost his security. He has lost his future. All of that in a heartbeat. Verse 17. God heard the boy crying, and the angel of God called Hagar from heaven, and he said to her, "What is the matter, Hagar? Do not be afraid. God has heard the boy crying as he lies there. Lift the boy up and take him by the hand, for I will make him into a great nation." What was Ishmael's name again? God hears. What does God say here? I have heard your cry. What does God do in this instance? He says, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to make him into a great nation. He says that over and over and over again. God is letting her know that he has a plan. I have a plan. Let me give you four lessons for us from this. Four lessons for us when we are experiencing loss. Number one, remember God's promise. Back in Genesis chapter 16, verse 10, God had said, I will so increase your descendants that they will be too numerous to count. In Genesis 21, 18, he says, I'm going to make him into a great nation. And so one of the things that God wanted her to do was to cling to these promises. It's not over yet. I have a plan. One of the verses that has encouraged me over the years that I've walked with the Lord is one you're all very familiar with, Romans 8:28. And we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him and those who have been called according to his purpose. It doesn't say there that all things are good. It says that we know that in all things God works together for the good. Has that verse ever encouraged you? This is one of the promises I cling to often. One of the things that we need to do is we need to remember God's promises. Isaiah chapter 41, verses 9 and 10. This is just filled with promises for God's chosen people. I said, you are my servant. I have chosen you and I have not rejected you. You know, in an instance like this, she probably really feels rejected. So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed. What does it mean to be dismayed? It means like really confused, like I don't know what to do. He says, don't be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you, and I will help you, and I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. You know, one of the things that we need to do when we're in the middle of a mess, this is a mess that she didn't create. This is a mess she found herself in. So we need to hold on to God's promises. God's not finished yet. Another thing we need to do is rely on God's plan. In Genesis 16:9, God told Hagar, I want you to return to Sarah. And one of the things that she might have said would be like, are you kidding? You want me to go back where I was being abused and misused? You want me to go back? And there are times where we say, you know, I don't like God's plan. I want to figure this out on my own. I want to do what I want to do. I think I should do this, or I feel like I should do that. But one of the things that we need to do when we find ourselves in the midst of a mess like this is we need to rely on God's plan. In Proverbs chapter 14, verse 12, it says this: "There is a way that seems right to a man, but in the end it leads to death." And there are times where, you know, it's like, I know what your word says over here, Lord, but you know what? I really think I ought to do it this way, or I really, you know, feel like I ought to do this way. And sometimes what we do with the Bible is we pick and choose. We go, I really like these verses right here. They really make me feel good, but I really don't like these commands over here. But what we need to do is we need to rely on God's plan. God's way may not make sense in the moment, but we know that his plans are for our good and they are full of hope. Jeremiah 29:11, one that many of us cling to. "For I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you, and plans to give you a hope and a future." This is exactly what she needs in this moment. Hagar didn't have an explanation. She only had a directive. God didn't tell her, this is what's going to happen, Hagar. You're going to go home, and you're going to be there, and you're going to have a new perspective. You're going to have a new identity. It's going to be really good for many, many years. God didn't tell her that. He just said this: I want you to go home. There are so many times in our lives where we can't see around corners, and we can't see over the hills, right? We don't know what's ahead of us. And so what we have to do in those situations is obey God in the moment. And then let what happens tomorrow, you know, God will show us what to do tomorrow. But we need to obey him for today. We need to rely on his plan. And God's directives don't always make sense. God's directives are hard at times. Forgive those who have hurt you, whether they apologize or not. That's a hard command. How about this one? Love your enemies. That's a hard command. How about this one? And this is what God is telling her to do in the moment. I want you to submit to bad leadership. That's a hard command. But yet that's what God tells her to do. Another thing that we need to do is we need to recognize God's provision. We need to recognize God's provision as we're going through this story. It says in verse 19, well, verse 18, "Lift the boy up and take him by the hand, for I will make him into a great nation." Verse 19, "Then God opened her eyes, and she saw a well of water. So she went and she filled the skin with water and gave the boy to drink." She's in this situation, and she doesn't know what to do. And God tells her what to do. "I want you to lift up the boy, and I want you to take him by the hand." And then immediately, suddenly, she sees a well that's right in front of her. Have you ever been in that situation? I don't know what to do. I don't know what to do. And then you say, "God, you know what I'm going to do? Is what you want me to do?" And then you open your eyes, and right there's God's provision. Right there it is. God says, "You know what? I'm going to provide for you now that you're willing to submit to my leadership." She recognizes God's provision. God enables her to see something that she had not been able to see, which was right in front of her eyes. Listen to this. Where God guides, he always provides. When God closes a door, he always opens up a window. God's got a plan for your life, and in the midst of that plan, he's going to provide for it. In Philippians chapter 4, verse 19, we're all familiar with this. "My God shall provide all of your needs according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus." I'm going to give you what you need. I believe it's Psalm 73, I believe it is. David writes, "I have never seen the righteous forsaken or their children begging bread. I am going to provide for you." Right now, this is where many of us are. We're watching our 401k, right? We're probably all doing this. And what we would really like to know is, what is it going to look like in 2 years? And it would really be nice if we knew what it was going to look like 5 years or 10 years, right? All we can do is make decisions based on the information we have today, right? We need to rely on God's provision, because we cannot see around corners. And then lastly, we need to rest in God's presence. Look at verse 20. It says this: God was with the boy as he grew up. He lived in the desert and became an archer. And while he was living in the desert of Paran, his mother got a wife for him from Egypt. Notice she didn't go back to Israel to get him a wife. We know what the wives are like back there, right? She had a bad experience with Sarah. So what she does is she goes down to Egypt and gets him an Egyptian wife. The part I want you to see is it says here that the Lord was with the boy as he grew up. And in the very same way, you know, God is with us when we're in the midst of our messes. In Genesis 16, verse 13, it says, "You are the God that sees me." She was from Egypt. Egypt was filled with all kinds of gods. They had gold gods and silver gods and wood statues and stone statues. And all those statues had eyes, but none of them could see. When she met the Lord, she came to understand that he was the one and only God, and that he sees her, and he sees her in her suffering. God provides her a wife. God provides a wife and therefore enables his promise, because there will be no kids without a wife. So I want to wind this up, but to wind it up, I have to tell you another story. We need to remember that God sees the picture when we only see what is before us. You know, this is a story of Abraham and Sarah and Hagar and Ishmael and then Isaac. We need to understand that Ishmael became the father of 12 tribes. And from Abraham through Isaac and Jacob, there were 12 tribes. Hagar and Ishmael were pushed out. Ishmael was no longer going to receive the inheritance that Abraham had. Jacob had how many sons? He had 12, right? And one of his sons was named Joseph. He was number 11. And Joseph was the favorite of Jacob because he was born of Rachel. He was number 11. And Jacob had given Joseph a beautiful multicolored coat. Remember, you all saw the musical, right? Okay. Joseph got a musical. But if you remember the story, Joseph had visions where one day his brothers would be bowing down before him. Joseph wasn't very wise. He shared those with his brothers. His brothers all hated him because he appeared prideful and arrogant. And so one day they're all off, they're tending sheep, and Joseph goes to visit with them. And when he gets there, all the brothers, they conspire against him, and they said, "You know, we got to get rid of this pesky little brother." And do you remember the story? They took him and they threw him in a cistern. And then they're thinking about, well, what are we going to do with him? And then a caravan comes by. The caravan is of Midianites, and they're headed to Egypt. And so they rethink what they're going to do. And so what they do is they lift him out and they sell him for 20 shekels to the Midianites. And the Midianites take him down to Egypt. You remember that story? What they do is they take Joseph's multicolored coat. They kill a goat. They put blood all over it. They go back to Jacob and they said, "Your favorite son has died. He was eaten by a lion." Okay, you remember that story? And then what he does is he goes down to Egypt. And while he's in Egypt, he ends up in a palace for a guy named Potiphar. Potiphar's wife accuses him of rape. He goes from the palace and he goes to a prison. He's in the prison for a long period of time. He has a dream, and in that dream, he's able to interpret the Pharaoh's dream. And because of that, he gets out of prison and he ends up in the palace as the number two in all of Egypt. You remember the story? Okay. Over a period of time, there's a famine in the land, and Joseph helps Israel or Egypt to prepare for the famine. The people up there in Israel, they're suffering too. So Jacob sends down his sons. His sons encounter Joseph. They don't recognize Joseph. And over a period of time, what happens is Joseph saves all of Egypt from the famine, and he saves all of Israel. You say, well, what does that have to do with Ishmael? Well, one thing we see is a verse that we really, really love, and it shows us that God has the big picture. Joseph says to his brothers, "You intended to harm me, but God intended it for good, to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives." Because of the harm that they had done to Joseph, now both Egypt and Israel are being saved. One of the things that happens is that the bloodline of Jesus is preserved because they didn't die. I want you to see one other verse. One other verse, because this ties it all together. Genesis 37:28 says that, "So when the Midianite merchants came by, his brothers pulled Joseph up out of the cistern, and they sold him for 20 shekels of silver to the Ishmaelites, who took him to Egypt." So it looks like this. Back here we have the story of Abraham and Sarah and I'm having a hard time. I want to say Rahab, but it's not. Hagar and Ishmael. And from that, they get kicked out. And then over a period of time, we see the bloodline of Abraham grow. We see the Jacob and then Joseph. And then we see what happens. He gets thrown into prison. And then we see, because of the Ishmaelites, Joseph ends up in Egypt. And he ends up saving everyone. If you'd go to Matthew chapter 1. Verse 1. "A record of the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Abraham was the father of Isaac, and Isaac was the father of Jacob. Jacob the father of Judah," and it goes on and on and on. And then in verse 16, "And Jacob the father of Joseph, the husband of Mary, of whom was born Jesus, who is called the Christ." Because the bloodline of Abraham and Isaac and Joseph and all of his brothers didn't die, later on we see that Jesus was born of that bloodline. A lot of that had to do with the fact that the Ishmaelites saved them. So where I want to go with that is this. God takes the unjust things done to us, the grievous things of our past, and he works them together for good. God used the Ishmaelites to bless and to save the Israelites. And because of that, we have Jesus, who is our Savior. We don't know how God is going to use the grievous things, the unjust things that have been done to us for the future glory of God and for the good of others. God is the master weaver of our stories. But we know this, in the midst of our mess, this is what we know. God hears our prayers and he sees our misery and that he cares for us. And in the midst of our mess, when all of our hope seems lost, God sees us, hears us, and he cares for us. And he can take the bad that's going on in your life, the mess, and he can turn it into a message. Let's pray. Father, I pray that today that we would, in the midst of our mess, things brought into our life, not of our own doing, Lord, that you would enable us to remember your promises. Father, I pray that you would help us to rely on your plan. I pray that you would help us to recognize God's provision. And Lord, I pray mostly that you would help us to rest in your presence. And I pray all of these things in Christ's name. Amen.